Good morning. How are you today? All right, let's get it started. Hope all is well with you today. The internet is crazy since I guess everybody's using it remotely, and it's just have given us a hard time getting connected these days and staying that way. Hope we can enjoy our music today without getting disconnected. Right, let's get this started.
Because you never know what life is going to take you in. You can't change where you've been. But today, I have the opportunity to choose. Here I am now, looking at 30, and I got so much to say. Gotta get this off of my chest, I gotta let it go today. I was always too concerned about what everybody would think. But I can live for everybody, I gotta live my life for me, yeah.
To the soles of my shoes,
I put myself in
so many chaotic circumstances. By the grace of God, I don't get
so many
second chances. Change where you've been, but today I have the opportunity to choose.
Yes, that's one of my favorite songs right there. I Choose by NDIRE. And today, with this being part two of Breonna Taylor Week, I am talking about choices. And the song that India's singing, she's talking about, I choose to be the best that I can be. I choose to be authentic in everything that I do. My past doesn't dictate who I am. I choose. And because you never know where life is going to take you, and you can't change where you've been. But today I have the opportunity to choose. And I want to encourage you with that today because in the wake of Breonna Taylor's death and verdict, she doesn't have any more choices. Her choices are over. And every moment that the living takes to make a choice is a grace moment. It's an opportunity to do it differently, to do it better, and to hear from God. And so today's grace spot is very short and kind of to the point. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about my experiences and maybe how some of those experiences relate to Brianna went through in her life, and how we can make the best choices possible, especially when we're given new mercies and grace every day we wake up. Every day we get up is another opportunity to make a better choice than we did the day before. Make the kind of choice that's going to impact not just our lives, but the people we work with, our families. We make choices that make the world different. And so I'm just gonna pretty much read to you what I've written, and hopefully you'll be encouraged by that today. For years as an elementary school counselor, I told my students, make good choices. As they entered into the building every morning, I'd say, Good morning. How are you today? Make good choices. And they would look back at me. And, you know, sometimes they would act like they didn't see me. And then other times they'd wave back. And then other times they'd run and give me a hug. But at the end of the day, I know I was not necessarily the first person in their life that day to tell them to make good choices. Their parents may have said it to them, their bus drivers. I hear a lot of adults saying that to little children. And after a while, I realized that may be a heavy request for a kindergartner. And having had my third kindergartner this year, I realized that that is a pretty big task to ask someone to make good choices, especially when they don't always have what they need to make those choices. And even a fourth grader or a fifth grader coming into school, the same school they've been in for 6 years, trying to figure out what is going to be the best choice for me today. What's going to be the choice that's going to determine whether I go home on green or on red? What is the choice if I make the wrong choice on my lunch menu? How's that going to affect my stomach? And will they believe me when I say the chicken nuggets made my stomach hurt? Or did my choices already mess me up for the day because I stayed up too late? That is a possibility. And now I'm tired and you're telling me to make good choices, lady. This is especially difficult when I have no idea what kind of night they had at home that night before. Even if it was a good night's rest, did they eat a good breakfast? Or do they even believe in themselves enough to trust their choices at all? Children have all kinds of faulty ideas about themselves. And as leaders and as counselors and educators, and parents, we don't always realize how much they're dealing with. We've been children, but we forget by the time we're adults how challenging it is to tell a kid to make a good choice, because they're dealing with all these concepts of who they are based on who people have been telling them who they should be and what they've been listening to in church, or what they've been listening to from their grandparents, or what the television is telling them and what the music is telling them. So it's very difficult when you tell a child to make a good choice versus giving them options and saying, these are your choices and both of these are good options. And I've learned as an educator that giving both of them, exactly, if they didn't eat the night before, that does happen, absolutely happens. But I have found that as an adult, if I give them choices that both work for me and I know they both work for them, then I give them more opportunity to make choices that pretty much work out regardless. And I don't think they think about it like that. They think about, when we say make good choices, they don't think about the options within choices. They just think about if it's good or bad, if it's right or wrong, if it's red or green, if it's up or down, if it's going to mean a goodie or a spanking. Now I spend my days trying to help eighth graders navigate their schedules, which is apparently a pretty big task, especially in virtual learning. They're trying to determine what they want to do with their future. And it seems like an even harder expectation for them. Well, you would think by the time they get in eighth grade that if you give them a choice that they're going to know right from wrong, or they're going to know out of the two good choices which one to make. But actually, decision making doesn't get any easier. I'm 41. And at this point in life, I see making good choices just as much of a challenge as I did when I was a child. The good thing that I think about that is Jesus does call us to have the spirits of children when we trust and lean and depend upon him. And so in the eighth graders, they look more like adults now. They're big kids. And for all practical purposes, they seem like they should be able to make good choices or to make choices that will help begin to define their life. But truly, on the inside, they're just as insecure, impressionable, and wondering if they now have the confidence to make the kind of decision that reflects their personality, their home life, their teacher's encouragement, and mostly their character. And so, generally speaking, we as adults have lots of challenges making good choices. And in the wake of this verdict, with the officers involved in the death of Breonna Taylor, I can't help but to wonder what choices they were making that ultimately led to her death. And I think about the choices that were made by the individuals in the court who had to weigh all the options, how heavy that must have been, and what was the process that they went through. I think about the choices Breonna may have made that in some way put her in a peripheral situation that would even remotely connect her to this ordeal at all. Or maybe she was making, at that point in her life, the right decisions, and she was still a victim of circumstance. So in some cases, it kind of makes you wonder, what difference does it make to make the right decision when life still gives you something else in spite of taking time to process it, pray about it, and have perspective on the choices that you're making? What difference does it make if ultimately you feel that the universe is just going to hand you whatever it's going to hand you? And a lot of people feel that way. I'm here to affirm you and tell you that I understand that when we wake up with the new mercies and we're given choices again, sometimes we don't always have the confidence to make those choices. And when we do finally make those choices and they don't always seem to be the right one, then we question God. We're like, well, why would you even lay that on my heart? Why even tell me to take the time to seek your face if I'm just going to end up in the same predicament or worse? And so with that, I want to encourage you today that all is not lost, that even though there are times when it seems like our choices don't matter, that our votes don't matter, that our voices don't matter, that Black lives don't matter, the expectations we have for our families don't always matter because they tend to choose to do different things, I'm here to tell you that they do matter. And here is why. The first scripture that I want to give you is Proverbs 14:12. And as I was studying, I realized that these are all scriptures that I truly live by when I think about how I make choices. And even if those things that I decide don't end up the way that I expected them to, life is one big hypothesis. And it's okay that it doesn't always end up the way that I expected it to. Most of the time it ends up better, and then sometimes it doesn't exactly end up better, but I can understand how God was working through my choice. And so Proverbs 14:12, it says, there is a way that seems right to a man, but its end is the way to death. There's a way that seems right to man, but it leads to death ultimately. And so what that lets me know is that within my own volition, with my own understanding, without having the ideas and the concepts and the precepts of the Bible really filtered in my life, I would really be dependent on Charnay to make good choices every day. I would be dependent on Charnay to how I mother and how I partner and how I carry out my counseling practice. That would be a lot for me in this finite nature that I'm in, this mind that I have, this body that God gave me. Not that it's not a good mind and a good body, but in and of ourselves, I think if we take on only our traits and only our mind, it seems right, right? Like, man, that's a really good choice. And I know I look back at some pictures and I think to myself, what in the world was I wearing? And then I look at it and I think, I get it. I kind of get it. It was a good choice for, 1998. I definitely get it. But if I was just leaning on my own, I think everything that I do would be correct. But the scripture says there's a way that seems right to man, but it leads to death or destruction or the end of something. And, you know, I realized that Proverbs 14:12, what it's really saying is that it's not always about thinking about what's right. Sometimes it's about thinking with a God mind. This actually seems like the right path to take, but really it could just be a good path. It doesn't necessarily have to be the right path, but by me seeking God's face, I don't want to be on a path that ends to death just because I think it's right. And sometimes we put our brothers and sisters in bad situations because it feels right at the moment. I had an experience recently that I have to admit, you know, caused a stumble, and I really hated that, but it felt so right. It felt exactly right. And in the end, I realized that all those right feelings and all those right emotions really led to an end of something that neither person in the situation really wanted to end, but it had to end because it just wasn't a right decision. It wasn't even a good decision, actually. And so seeking God's face helps us to prevent death. Actually, it really does. When we lean to our own rightness, our own correctness that we have developed within and of ourselves, there's a good chance that not only could it be an end or a death in our life, but it could be an end or a death in our brothers and sisters' lives. So we have to be very careful. The next verse that I want to share with you is, "Enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide, and the way is easy that leads to destruction. And those who enter by it are many, for the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few." That's Matthew 7:13-14. Now, what I love about this is I hear Christ saying that when we're really trying to make a good choice, when we're really trying to do what's best for our family, where we're going to live, what we're going to eat, how we're going to navigate our day, the bottom line is those choices tend to be very narrow and focused. Sometimes they take a lot of time and a lot of prayer and a lot of focus and energy that is required to help us get to that ultimate answer. And so if you can imagine going through a very narrow gate, it might even be a little too small for your hips, and getting through that, because that's actually the best route to your destination versus an open field. It's almost like I could take a 2-lane highway to get to a place, or I could take a 4-lane interstate. Ideally, we think the interstate is going to be a quicker way. We call it the freeway. There, we can drive faster on the freeway than we usually can on a 2-lane road, simply because there's just not enough road for you to go any faster. So the speed limit might be 45. But on the highway, the speed limit might be 65. And you know how we do it. We're going to put that extra 10 on it and make it 75 so we can get there even quicker. The challenge with that is a lot of people are going to be traveling that road. And ultimately, we could get in traffic because everybody had the same idea that we had. They didn't think about the back road. They didn't think about taking that additional route or that one way. Where once they get on it, it could be a while before they can get off of it. But if you're a driver, if you've had any experience driving at all, you know that sometimes those back roads are the quickest way. And when I met my husband, I realized he was back road king. And I would think to myself, why are we, it's dark back here, there are no lights, why are we on this road? And what I realized was that these back roads get me where I need to be in Georgia a lot quicker, because Georgia has a lot of back roads, a lot of trees, a lot of one ways. But it prevented me from being in traffic. It prevented me from having to go out of the way. And it prevented me from being on the road with hundreds of other people at the same time with the same idea. And sometimes the idea, the vision God has for your life and your calling is very narrow. A lot of people won't understand it. Sometimes you could share your idea with 10 people in one day, and only one person will say, you know what? I think you're onto something. So I've always really appreciated when making choices to think about the way called straight is narrow. And I say it all the time. Well, the way called straight is narrow. Not a lot of people find it. And so when you have a good idea, don't frown upon it if you don't get a lot of amens right away. Some of the best ideas in the world, and we hear people talk about it. We hear about the evolution of Apple computers and their products and Microsoft. We think about even the evolution of our president and how he became the man that he is and got to the White House. A lot of people doubted him. I doubted him. I'll be the first to say. But that's where he sits today. And so, and he's our leader and clearly the leader of the free world. But there took a lot of narrow choices to get him there. And I'm not saying that I agreed with those, but there's a very fine line when it comes to meeting your goals. It's very acute and it's very specific. But don't get discouraged, because when God has a plan for you, even Saul wasn't considered necessarily a good king, but he saw a path to victory that was very slender in the Old Testament, and he got there. And I think there's a lesson there. The next verse I want to share with you is James 1 and 5. And it says, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given him. So now we're not talking about choices. Now we're talking about wisdom. Do we need wisdom to make the best possible choice or the right choice at that time? Because sometimes what could seem practical and what could seem correct could be the absolute wrong thing to do. And what I think is amazing is we still think in our little human finite capacity that what we believe is right. And we get on Facebook, we get on Twitter, we repost on Instagram, we send text messages in our family groups. We insist that based on the knowledge that we have, that we're voting correctly, that we're taking the correct stance when it comes to oppression and discrimination, that we put our kids in the best school and we're standing by our decision. But the key is, what wisdom have you received? What has experience taught you? How do you understand what you're hearing from God and what you're overhearing from the people that you lead in your household, the people that you lead in your community, or the people that you work with? Are you really overhearing it? Because what could look right could be disastrous for a lot of people. Ideally, someone thought it was a good idea to build a big wall to prevent people from getting into the United States of America. But we still have immigration issues. There are still people migrating here as refugees. They are trying to get away from terrible situations. There are also, I would assume, people getting here for not the good reasons. But guess what? The wall is not preventing it. It's not. I mean, that's just a natural fact. Like, any statistical data that you look at says people are still getting in. So what does that say? That ideally you think if you build a big enough wall, you can keep people from doing things that they shouldn't do. But mankind always finds a way to do what it wants to do. So wisdom will let us know that that's probably not the most practical way to reform immigration. That's just basic. That's just basic looking at the data, looking at the situation, meditating on it, and trying to figure out a better way. So if you lack wisdom, it says, ask God, because he gives freely, generously. And a lot of times we have not been the recipients of wisdom and making good choices because we've never sought God's face. Not really. I mean, we may tell somebody, God bless you, and we may say, Lord, help me in my day. But when have we really taken the time to meditate and think about what is actually going to be the most specific way to help this student, to get my family out of this financial rut, to get my spirit out of this depression? What can I do to hear from God? Have I spent time alone? Have I tried to meditate in His word? Am I taking God at His word? Am I actually trying Him? The word says, try Him. Try Him at His word. Let Him fail you. I know He won't. I know wisdom will speak. And I know even if the situation gets more dire before it gets better, I still realize that wisdom is at work. And sometimes it's just about faith. Wisdom will tell you that in spite of what it looks like, it's already better. Wisdom will tell you that in spite of the fact that I'm still sick, I'm already healed. Wisdom will tell you that in spite of the fact I don't have any money in my account, I still have favor and I still have everything that I need. God has already supplied all of my needs. So guess what? Maybe I don't need money in my bank today. Maybe I just don't. Maybe God has already supplied me with what I need. That's what wisdom would do. But in our own mind, making choices based on what we think we have in our hand is never going to be enough because we're always going to come up empty. But once we embrace that wisdom of God to make good choices, to make the right choice, now we're looking at something different. Now we're living in the sweet spot of God. Now we're living in the eye of where He's calling us. And you can live there. Never doubt where you can go in Christ. Never doubt it based on what you see or what even what you feel. Sometimes you have to go based on what you know about God and your trust in Him. And that is not always easy because these eyes are a trip. And when I say these eyes, I mean even our mental vision of what we can see can be so, so small. But what God has designed for us is so big. So with that being said, I have a little story that I want to share. And it's about a kid in a candy store. A kid walked into a candy store with his dad and was bedazzled by the array of treats on offer. What should I choose? He asked himself. Come on, son. We don't have all day, his dad said. These are my favorites. No. Wait. These are my favorites. He walked along the aisles, picking up bags and putting them back. He just couldn't make up his mind. Quick, son. Make up your mind. We have to go, his impatient dad said, frantically. The boy ran around the store, his eyes moving from one shelf to another, but all of the options looked so good, and he could not make a decision. Eventually, the dad had enough, grabbed his son by the hand, and they walked out of the store empty-handed. The young boy had tears in his eyes. He wanted them all, but he ended up with nothing because he couldn't choose just one. We're all that boy. The world is that candy store. We have a myriad of options available to us. But if we don't make a decision about our career, education, relationships, investments, church, or other important issues, we end up empty-handed. Sometimes we worry about making the wrong choice. What if we regret the direction that we take and it's too late to go back? The bigger danger is that we make no decision at all and end up going nowhere and doing nothing. And so with that being said, consider the scriptures today. Consider making a choice. Don't let time run out on your life or the situation. That is called living a default life. That is also living a life outside of God. When you don't make decisions, you make decisions. So I am inviting myself to say something different to my students today. I am inviting myself to say, when you don't make a decision, you make a decision. So make a decision. It's okay if it ends up not necessarily producing what you thought it would, but it's important that you make a decision, and it's important that you look outside of yourself as to what could be all the possibilities. Believe in yourself, believe in your ability to make choices, but also trust in God. Have your faith. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God. When you go into those situations at work that you feel like you can't handle, dealing with those employees that you've been trying to wrestle with for months, that child that wants to wear something different like most of mine do every morning when I get their clothes out, I still have to make wise decisions to love them. We still have to make wise decisions because they don't just impact us. They impact other people. And so in the wake of the Breonna Taylor verdict, her life, her death, her legacy, don't just make good choices today. Make a choice. And I pray that you have a blessed day, that you go with God. If you missed the scriptures, please go back and watch it later. And I just want to pray for you right now. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning thanking you and praising you for another opportunity to experience your grace and your mercy. We know that you are with us, that it's not always about us making the right choice. Sometimes it's about hearing from you and making the wise decision, the hard decision, the unpopular decision, that thing that nobody else agrees to but us. And sometimes you give us confirmation. You show us little things in life. You give us ideas and visions and hopes and callings. And we second guess ourselves. We second guess our purpose because of what it looks like. Father, I ask that no matter what it looks like today, no matter what we think these eyes are showing us, help us to see what you see. The potential, the opportunity, the chance to make somebody else's life better, the chance to grow, the chance to not just earn more money, but know what to do with it, the chance to see that there's a way that seems right to us, but it could lead to a very bad end. So it is your knowledge, your wisdom, your faith that you've given us that we put our trust in today. Heavenly Father, we know that you are the Father of lights and that all good and perfect gifts come from you. There is no variation in your perfect will. And as we seek your perfect will today, we ask that you fashion our hearts and our minds in you. No matter what the world tells us about our voting and our impact in our community, we know that we have great impact because we serve you. And if you're for us, God, who can the world be against us? So we love you. We praise you. We thank you. And we look forward to the victory of not the making the good choice or the right choice, but making the choice that you've designed for us. But ultimately making a choice. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Go with God today. And I hope that this lesson helped a little. I know it helped me. I'll talk to you later. Bye.